You've done the rest. Some of them did, and in one day 23,000 of them died. We should not test the Lord as some of them did, and they were killed by snakes. And do not grumble as some of them did and were killed by the destroying angel. These things happened to them as examples, are written down as warnings for us, on whom the fulfillment of the ages has come.
Yeah, as our Bible reading shared, God took care of his people through Jesus. All these good things that happened in their lives, Jesus was sort of like the example of that. Jesus was what was behind them. And then they're warned not to take that for granted. And so, first off, just if you're interested about our church, want to know, what does this church stand for? Well, here's our motto. We, the church, as followers of Jesus, will love as Jesus loved, will teach what Jesus taught, and obey as Jesus obeyed. And that's not to say that we actually do it perfectly all the time, but that's what we're aiming for. Is we want to take Jesus seriously, to take his example seriously, and follow him with the strength that God provides through his Holy Spirit. So that's an overarching thing. Through the last few months, as a church, we've been looking specifically starting at this part in Hebrews chapter 12, where we're told that we're sort of like those people that were mentioned, the Israelites from the reading of 1 Corinthians, where they were on this moment of being set free from slavery and headed towards God's promise for them. That's the really short part of their story. And in the middle of that story, there's all these lessons that they were learning about how to really be the people of God. And so in Hebrews 12, it's also looking at that picture and saying, you're like those people, but not in the way of coming to a God who's meant to scare you off, but instead you've come to a God who is going to give you an unshakable kingdom. And because of that, there's ways that we should live as the people of God. So we've been looking at what are these unshakable things? What's part of this unshakable kingdom? And Hebrews 12:28 says that since we're receiving a kingdom that is unshakable, let us be thankful and please God by worshiping him with holy fear and awe. And last week we talked about this holy fear of God, this awe. And it made sense this week to make sure that we don't forget the let us be thankful part of that verse. So we're going to talk about thankfulness and unshakable thankfulness. If you want a title, it's that. Let me start on something that might not seem like thankfulness, but if I try to encourage people to be more thankful, in a way, it makes me feel like I'm trying to encourage you to take cold showers. And for those of you that know this part about me, I'm weird as far as like temperature regulation, where I don't get cold normally as quickly as most people. And it's not just my wife, though my wife is definitely one of those persons. Like, aren't you cold? I'm like, no, I'm not. But throughout my life, I've had so many friends like, man, like, aren't you cold? So if I try to say, cold showers, they're good for you, people will be like, that's nice, that's good for you. Maybe it's just good for you because you're weird like that. So let me be a medical dork, because some of my dad was in the medical field, my mom was in the medical field, my wife is in the medical field. I somehow like medical people. So here's something about cold showers. Cold showers are good for so many reasons. They bolster your immunity to getting the common cold. Because like the shock of the cold water, it stimulates the blood cells that you have to fight off infection, the leukocytes. And so a study that was done in the Netherlands, this isn't from somewhere else in the world, a study in the Netherlands showed that people who regularly took cold showers, they called out sick from work 29% less than people who didn't take a cold shower. Are you convinced yet? You should take cold showers. You will call out less sick from work. Cold showers combat symptoms of depression. In one study, people who took cold showers daily reported decreased depression symptoms and an increase in their mood, decreased since your body's not what is going on with me, then it fights harder to pump your blood. It stimulates your body to increase that blood flow circulation, which is helpful for anyone who has high blood pressure or diabetes. So if you have those things, cold showers can be helpful. It increases your metabolism, so your body has to expend more energy, thus burning calories, if you're cold, to warm yourself back. It's light, it shouldn't take the place of dieting or exercise, but it helps with that. It reduces inflammation, prevents muscle soreness, and it can relieve localized pain, partly because it's like reducing inflammation, which is part of what causes pain, but it's also because it gets your body to focus on something else than the pain, it's focusing on how cold it is. So with all of that, who wants to now start taking cold showers daily? I've got a few that are interesting. Now, I said my wife is medical. I have tried to tell these things to my wife. She's like, no. And I was like, no. And I get it. If someone talks to you about cold showers in the future, you might be like, yeah, that's a good thing. Sure, they're good for you. But I'm not actively trying to do more like that. And I feel like Thanksgiving is one of those things. People are like, oh yeah, if I tell you all the things it's good for, you'd be like, yeah, that's a good thing. And, you know, maybe I'll do it some of the time. But it's not like that one thing that's really going to save my life. It's not going to change my world just because of being thankful. Right? If you heard today there's going to be a sermon about Thanksgiving, you might be interested. I didn't think it was going to change my life. I think it might. Not just from the practical side, like physical health things, but there are also the same people who did the research about cold showers have done research about thankfulness. That's why I think it's some of the same. And if you practice gratitude 15 minutes a day, 5 days a week, for at least 6 weeks, so you're making it a habit, right? Like it's you build a habit of it, it can change your thought process, and some of the things it can do is reduce depression symptoms, get higher life satisfaction, build stronger social relationships, give you more self-esteem, lessen anxiety, relieve stress, because it initiates the parasympathetic nervous system. If you've never heard of parasympathetic nervous system, that's okay. Just know that it means something good. And it can support your heart health because it gives you a drop in diastolic blood pressure and it improves sleep. So if you don't want to take cold showers, just be thankful. And it does a lot of the same things. So even people who do not believe in a God will say, thankfulness, yeah, that's good. But it's like as Christians, as people who follow God, like thankfulness should mean more to us than that. Because yes, thankfulness is good for us because it's how we're made. God created us in a way that thankfulness would be good for us. But it's not just how we're made. It's why we're made. And some people might think I'm overstating it. I'm saying it again. Being thankful is why we are made. 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 16 to 18. I've used this verse multiple times in sermons now, focusing on thankfulness. Be joyful always, pray continually, and give thanks in all circumstances. Because this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. I don't think it's only teenagers, but especially a lot of my friends, when we were teenagers as Christians, there's this whole like, what is God's will for my life? What am I supposed to do? Exactly. And like, what job am I supposed to get? What study am I supposed to study? Am I supposed to study? Should I not study? Who am I supposed to marry? Or should I not get married? Where am I supposed to live? What, all these things, and it's like this existential crisis. What's God's will for my life? We've got a Bible verse that says it.
Be joyful always. Pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances. This is God's will for your life. God created you because he wanted you to be joyful, praying, and thankful. Now, I'll explain a little bit more of why I think that is, but just realize that if you're choosing not to be thankful, you're going against what God wants in your life. And I'm not saying be thankful for every bad thing someone does. And that's important. Like, the thankfulness, there's a question of who that's directed to and what it's directed for. And the thankfulness is to God for what he's doing, not just for our own. We don't have to thank God for sin that we do. So it's not thank God for everything that happens, but thank God in circumstances, because we've even been told that God is able to work for the good of those who love him in all circumstances, even in the sinfulness of other people. God is able to be working toward good. So we can thank him for what he's doing, even if we're not thankful for everything everyone else is doing. So, we should thank God because it's our reason for living. Well, let's give the opposite. What would be the danger of not being thankful? I mean, number one, you're missing your purpose in life. That's a big deal, I think. Especially in a culture that is so focused on, like, individuality and purpose. To totally miss your purpose would be a big thing. But the danger of unthankfulness, if it's what God has made us for, then doing the opposite is not, like, a lesser evil. It's not like this little thing on the side that doesn't matter so much. It's not like, oh, I decided to take warm showers instead of cold showers because I just don't feel like taking a cold shower. Like, fine, skip a cold shower, but like, oh, I just don't feel like being thankful. That can lead to major problems. Let's go back to our Bible, 1 Corinthians, where we're told that all these things that happened to the people of God on this trip from slavery to where God wanted them to be, we're meant as examples for us. And then we're given four examples of, like, don't do this and that and that and that. Warnings, we're told, because those things that they were doing led to problems. So there are four warnings. The first two warnings have to do with idolatry, with the people saying, we'd rather have a different God than the God who is with us. There's this time where they create a golden calf, an idol, and they started worshiping that and kind of thinking, how about we go back to Egypt? Let's go back to slavery. And that leads to problems. We're told, yeah, don't do that. And most of us today would say, oh yeah, idolatry, that's a bad thing. That's not good idolatry. The second thing he says is, don't fall into, like, sexual immorality, as some of them did. And that story is more connected with idolatry than we realize as well. Because there's, like, this group of people that those that are the people of God decide to start just having relations with people who don't follow this God, and they start following the idols while they're at it. So it's the, like, oh, okay, well, we're gonna just not pick the people who are going to lead us toward God, lead us instead towards worshiping Baal and other gods. So that leads them to idolatry. So the first two strongly have to do with idolatry and how that affects our lives. The next two after that says, don't test the Lord. And that one is related to a moment when they start complaining. They get mad at Moses because of what Moses is doing. They get mad at Moses because he's leading. There are people who complain about Moses leading, and God brings a judgment on them because the earth swallows these men up. And then people blame Moses for them dying, as though Moses is the one who's able to make the earth open up. And so God gets mad at the people who are complaining about Moses, and they face a plan. Their complaining led to more people dying, honestly. And then the fourth one, he says, and don't grumble against the Lord. And again, it's people saying, why did you bring us here? Why are we going through this whole process of living in a desert It would be better if we just went back to Egypt. It would be better if we were back in slavery. It would be better if we just had our lives like they were before instead of being here. Yeah, you fed us at times. You've given us water in miraculous ways. But this isn't as good as what we would have had. And they're grumbling against God. And it leads to snakes going through the cave. God takes complaining and grumbling seriously. It's not like one of those ones that's way down on us and like, oh, that's just a little bit.
Like a bit bad. It's like,
yeah, we should go kill people. Like, that's bad. Idolatry, that's bad. Complaining.
No. There's a major danger to us choosing not to recognize God's goodness. So what is thankfulness? Or how should we approach it? I mean, if it's why we're made, and working against why we're made isn't helpful for us, then why should we do it? Well, if it's part of how to create it, it's good to maybe start at creation. So we're told at the beginning of the Bible, like, God makes the world, and as he makes things, he sees that it's good. God is glad with the work he did. I don't know if we can say he's thankful to himself, but maybe. Like, God looks at things and says, this was good. God isn't complaining about what he made. He's speaking positive. He makes humans. He says, this was good. I made it good. God puts us, as humanity, on an earth that he made that was good, hoping that we will enjoy the goodness he's made. Interact with him in the goodness that he's made. And continue to recognize that he's the one who made all the goodness. That's being joyful always, is enjoying the goodness he made. It's praying continually, it's interacting with him in the sphere of the good things he's made. And recognizing that he's the one who made them good is being thankful to him. And if we follow that, that's following how it's created. It's joining with God and saying, hey, this is good. I mean, so I have two sons. And I get that as a parent. I don't want to just like things. I want my kids to like them too. You ever had that where, like, there's foods that you love that you want to share with someone, hoping that they will realize the goodness in it as well? You ever had that, like, disappointment when someone's like, man, it's okay. It's okay. Did you not taste that? That's good. It's so delicious. God wanted to share those things. There are stories that I love that now I'm reading with my sons because I want them to realize the story is good. I want them to learn to appreciate what I appreciate. And especially if I'm the one who made it, all the more so. Right? God is the one who made the good foods, the good stories, and the good work to do, and wants us to see it and be like, yeah, that's really good. That's part of where our thankfulness is supposed to come from. But then the problem in the story is that humanity starts wanting to be the ones who get to say what's good and not good, and they want to say the things that God says aren't good are good. And things that God said are good are not good, and we throw sin into the mixture and we cause the problems. So that's why I say we're not supposed to be thankful for our sin, but we are supposed to continue even in those, seeing that there's a God who's at work for the good, and we can be thankful for that. The Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 7 is going through looking at his life and saying, why are the good things I want to do, I'm not getting them done? The things I don't want to do, and the things I am doing, I realize I'm not good. I'm a mess. Who can save me from this? And the next line is, thanks should be to God, who delivers me through Jesus Christ. The solution to our problems is God working through Jesus for our good, and we can be thankful for that every moment. no matter what's going on in our life. So, thankfulness has to do with realizing that what God said is good really is good. Some things that thankfulness is not. Thankfulness is not comparison. It's not seeing that your life is better than someone else's life, and so you're thankful for that. I'm gonna admit, that's one of the things that like bugs me so much when I hear that in testimonies of people being like, oh, God's so good because I saw this other person's life, and I'm just like, wow, I'm so glad I'm not there. Thank you, God.
No, that's not where
thankfulness is supposed to come from. There's this story that Jesus tells about two men going up to pray. One of them seems like a very religious man. One of them is seen as the lowest part of society, a tax collector. They hated them. And we're told that the religious man stands up and says, God, I thank you so much that I'm not that sinner. And Jesus gives the moral of the story and says that guy doesn't get hurt by God. Because that's not the thankfulness God's looking for. Right? Anytime that we're trying to put ourselves over people just so that we can look down on others, that's not what God's looking for. In part because it also means like I have more reason to thank God than you do because my life is better than yours. But we have a God who says that everyone has the ability to be joyful always, pray continually, and give thanks in every circumstance. So they may have less money than you, but that doesn't mean they shouldn't be able to thank God as much and more than you do. They may have fewer Christians that live around them. That doesn't mean that they can't be thankful. They might face more persecution in their country than you do. That doesn't mean they have less reason to be thankful to God. And honestly, I've met people in all those circumstances that are far more thankful than most people I know who live in comfort. Thankfulness is not based upon how comfortable your life is. So it's not based on comparison, it's not based upon you being comfortable. Thankfulness is also not based on ignorance. Some people treat it like that, like, they can be thankful because they don't know how bad it is. Ignorance is bliss. As long as you just pretend like evil doesn't exist, you can be thankful for stuff. Again, it's not the situation that I've seen with my own eyes, because I've been in some of the poorest countries of the world, I've been in some of the most, like, satanic, honestly, ones that have literally said, oh, we give ourselves over to demons, one of them does. Like, I have seen dangerous places, and I've seen people who are thankful in those, not because they're ignorant of the evil around them, but because they understand the God that they serve, the power he has, the promise that they're given for this life and for eternity. And they can be thankful no matter what happens. So, people who are thankful are not ignorant optimists. I think people who really understand God are going to be the optimists that are thankful about more than anyone else. That doesn't mean that we don't admit that evil exists. We just choose what we focus on. And we're focusing on God is bigger than us. So thankfulness is somewhat about choosing perspective. Thankfulness is about, instead of choosing to look at the negative, or to look at the problems and only see the problems, it's choosing to even see through problems a God who is good. There's a story in the Bible, maybe you've heard of Joseph. It's in the book of Genesis. And Joseph is this young man who God gives all these promises to, and because of that, a lot of his brothers get jealous of him. They sell him into slavery. He later gets in trouble and thrown in jail because he hasn't done anything wrong. And like he keeps having these problems. And at the end of this story, when God has made good on all these promises, and his brothers show up again, they're worried that Joseph is going to now do mean things to them because the tables have been turned and Joseph, who was the slave, is now this powerful man. They're like, oh no, Joseph's gonna like probably kill us. And Joseph's comments to his brothers is this: what you meant for evil, he's willing to admit it, right? He's not there, but they were trying. No one says, you put me in slavery because you loved me. No. He said, what you meant for evil, God meant for good. And Joseph could see that there is a God working good even through the sinfulness of other people, and he could be thankful for that. And not have to be one who took out revenge or took out retribution. Last quick thing. There's a picture of me from about 10 years ago that you will see on the screen. I know it looks like it's probably 10 days ago, but it's actually 10 years. Nine-ish. Back in the period of God had brought this incredible woman named Christina into my life, and we agreed to get married to each other, and figuring all that out. In that process, I was praying and saying, God, like, what is it that you want? Like, what is it you want from this relationship, right? Well, what do you want from our marriage? And the three words that I felt like God said, these are what I want you to focus on, were trust, gratitude, and generosity. That if there was anything that we would do, that we would do it through first trusting God and trusting each other. That we would be grateful to God every day, and we would learn to be grateful for each other and speak things that were encouraging to each other. And that we would be generous to God, to each other, to the people that we came in contact with. I had the, like, if one day people are talking about Matt and Christine, and they said, what are Matt and Christine like? These were the three words I wish people would say. If you're around them, you can tell that they trust God so deeply. And there are people that are like grateful, and like when you're around them, it's just natural, it's easy to be grateful to others. Like it's just, I don't know, sometimes being around them, it shows that this is a generous people. They're not acting like they have too little, but instead they're willing to give to others, and it just, I don't know, rubs off on you. That was my hope. Maybe I should have started with those of you who know Christine and I. What three words would you use for us? I'm not sure that these would be the three that everyone would use, but know that that's my goal. Gratitude is choosing for a relationship, right? You're not really thankful in a vacuum. You're thankful in relationship. That's part of why I don't think thankfulness has to do with comparing with others, because that's pushing others away. And it's not based on ignorance, because that's trying to pretend like other things don't exist. Relationship doesn't do that. Relationship draws people closer. And thankfulness is about drawing closer to God first. So thankfulness is in relationship. So what can you do to be more thankful? I want to give you some practical ideas. Quickly. One practical idea is write Thanksgiving things down. Some people have like a prayer journal where they like they keep track of like here's my prayer request, but here are the things I'm thankful for. Other people just say like keep a gratitude journal or something, but like write it down. Take time to be like, I am stopping other stuff I'm doing just so I can be thankful. Right? We should be thankful at all times, but it can be good to like stop. And take a moment to realize it. And someone will make rest and sad has to do with it. But don't just write it down and speak it out. Some people, it's really easy for them to just go say thank you to everybody. Others, like, it's hard for them to say thank you. If you're one of those, practice it. I don't know, go stand in front of a mirror, say thank you a few times, and then go out and tell someone thank you. In your prayers, tell God thank you. Right? Don't just keep it inside, but actually speak it out. Third idea, like, stop and think while you're doing it. It can be so easy for us to just say thanks. It's like in American English, if you're in a store and like, oh, here's some change, thanks, and then like walk off. And we can say it as a reflex. When you find yourself saying thank you, or you find a moment to say thank you, don't just like do it thoughtlessly, but choose to thoughtfully stop and realize, why are you saying thank you? Right? So many prayers I know of start with, God, thank you for this day, or thank you for this food. And we'll say it, like, we know that that's the line that's supposed to be said, and so we say it, and then like, okay, here's the rest of the prayer. So like, here's the start, I say hi, now let me get to the real stuff. Make thankfulness, like, part of the real stuff that you stop and think about. Why are you choosing to be grateful? And a last thing is, don't know if there's a better way to say it, there probably is, but feed yourself carefully. Choose what inputs you're giving yourself. Because like sometimes we choose to read things, or to listen to things, or to watch things that don't encourage thankfulness. I admit, I like melancholy emotions. I like listening to music that makes me feel melancholy, which is this like kind of sad, but not too sad, but sort of sad thing. And I'm not saying those are all bad, right? But like, are we choosing things that cause emotions? Like, there's a branch of rock music that's rage rock. The whole idea is to make you feel rageful. That's why it's called that, right? Like, I'm angry at everything. Some people would say that's the heart of rock and roll, is expressing our anger. I think rock and roll can be used for good. That's its own story. But like, sometimes that can be music, right? Like, I've known people who, if all you're doing is feeding your mind with things that are making you unhappy, that's not gonna help you be thankful. So maybe find something that will help check that, right? I'm not gonna say all worship music is the best music to listen to, but like, that's why people, that can be a really good idea. Like, focus on songs with lyrics that help you realize that God is good. There's plenty of like television that is not made to make you feel like God is good. You can probably just leave it at that. One of the things for me, confession time. So like, I have a game on my phone that I play sometimes. It's called Angry Birds, and I'm realizing it's called Angry. Like, it literally has it in the title. It's not there to make me feel thankful. Or if it is, it's because I'm comparing I beat someone else against its own thing. Like, it's a game, right? I'm not saying all games are bad, but it's good for us to realize, are we feeding ourselves things that encourage us towards living out what God created us for? To be thankful to Him for His goodness. To enjoy what He's made and interact with Him in that. Or are we feeding ourselves things that drive us from that? So maybe it would be good for you to just take some time and think through, like, what are things I can feed myself so I can be thankful? So what's going to happen soon is we're going to sing some more songs that are meant to be like thankful, praiseful songs to give you the chance to like express with that music. But also, we'll have some of the time in there. If you have something you want to thank God for, we want to give the chance for people to share that. I think you've already noticed. Please don't make it a comparison thank you, because I'll just shake my head in the background. But like, you can think of what's something you're thankful to God for, and maybe a few people can share. If everyone shared for like 10 minutes, no one's going to be around 5 minutes. But like, if you have something short that you'd like to share, we'd be glad to give you that opportunity to put into practice what you've heard, to be thankful. Yeah? So let me pray, and then we're going to sing some, and you can think about what's maybe something that God deserves your thanks for. And we can find ways to share that. Heavenly Father, you know how to give good gifts. So thank you. that protects us, that knows what we need, one that understands what's going on around us better than we do. You know how many times I think I know as well as you, and I want to give you advice, but God, you truly do know better than me. And I want to learn to see things like you do. So I'm going to start by saying thank you for being willing to share your perspective with me and share a relationship with me. And thank you for making that available to each person in this room. May we be people who are joyful and thankful. May that be something that this church is known for, that we're thankful people. Because you deserve that, thanks. So help us to express it well, to grow in it, and to know more and more what it is to enjoy the good world that you made. In Jesus' name, amen.
It's been a cold, it's not been a good time. So this last week, Aline, the kids and I went to the Students for Christ conference, where we met with student groups from all across Europe. And there are people from different backgrounds, different places in the world coming together. And that reminded me a lot of our church, where we come as well from so many different places, from so many different cultures. We probably raised different types of churches where we even focus on different aspects of the Bible, but we can come here together as one church. So I'm thankful for God that we have one God, that we have one Spirit, and that we can be united despite all these differences, because He is one.
I'm thankful for being here and being able to spend time with my daughter in the Netherlands, although I'm not from here. And I'm thankful for being alive and for being able to share in the service and realizing how important it is to be grateful. Thank you. First of all, I want to thank for salvation, because without it, why how was possible that we were here? I want to thank God for my husband, who is a wonderful husband. He is always there for helping me. And I want to thank God for the fact that I'm living now in Netherlands. Since I was a little child, I asked God, I don't know how many years, please let me visit Europe to these different countries and blah blah blah. And everyone, my parents went, well, came a couple of times, and my sister for her 15th birthday, food, and it was so like, for me, like, how's it possible that I've been praying for years and years and never? So I decided to stop praying because I said, what for? There's no point. And God had a better plan because he considered, no, you won't visit Europe, you will live in Europe, and you won't just be alone in Mexico. No, you will have a husband in Europe. And I'm very, very grateful to God for all these things and many others.
I am very grateful for standing here, giving thanks to the Lord and worship because I don't know that's what I love to do. I've been in and out of depressions all my life, and I'm very thankful that God helps me through it. It's a process. It's what Pastor Matt also said, very careful what you feed yourself with. And so it's so important. So I'm very grateful to be back also in this church because I've been gone for a while, and I'm very thankful for standing here so I can give thanks to the Lord.
I would like to thank the Lord for saving the life of my wife, Mary.
It's been lovely.
Yeah. Ah, yes. Yeah.
I'm very thankful, of course, first of all, my wife, that we are married. Thanks to the Lord that He bless us with a marriage. And also for realizing that this world is quite, it's very fallen, and that we have in this country, for example, the privilege of coming together as brothers and sisters. Knowing that in other countries it is impossible, you know, for Middle East or whatever. So I'm thankful to the Lord that we have still the opportunity to come together.
As it is mentioned that we are from different cultures, so I am originally from Pakistan. So I served my whole life. Today, before I got up, I even dream that there was a program like this. This is church. So when I was near to get up, so I saw the program that some choir is singing that Jesus is alive and He is living forever. This song was singing in the program. So I think that there is no big subject than this, that our God is living God and He is forever living. My name is Johnson.
Science. I'm really happy that I'm born today, and that that need correction. And again, that there's so many people day by day working to bring order from chaos.
About, and particularly in such a society where it's very easy to be privileged or entitled, it's really good to just stop and think about how much there is to be grateful for, because the more you start to think about it, the more you realize that is to be grateful for. So, yeah, I'm just thankful that I can be thankful this morning after being very much not
morning, church. Every new day when I wake up, I feel very blessed, and there are thousands of reasons that we and I have to be thankful for, and I'm really aware of that every new day that I open my eyes. But being living this life and see also so many brokenness in the world, and my family, my life, and my friends' life, family, in the news, everywhere, I think what the biggest gifts, what God gives us, is health, mentally, emotionally, spiritually, physically, and love, and freedom. And that's what we, if I look around, we have in a major amount. So I feel very blessed by that. And people want to have a career or be something or do something, but being healthy and being love and being showing love and receive love is, I think, one of the biggest gifts. And I asked my husband, what are you thankful for? And he said that God gave me a second chance, because a couple of years ago I was standing in the hospital by his bed. I was like, oh God, are you going to take him to heaven? But God gave him a second chance, and we know that both of us, that every day is a day where you can fully live.
This is also an achieved story about in 2020. I thought, well, it's my time to go. I collapsed the 9th of June. 3 days later, I walked out of the hospital with a pacemaker. I call him a peacemaker. And he gave me a second chance. And this is the reason to be thankful, because if there is no life, you cannot be thankful. So thankful for many things, but most of all thankful for getting a second chance. And every time again, I think of this song, he's not finished with me yet. So normally the song is about, you're not finished with me yet, but for sure he's not finished with me yet. Thank you.
Hello, church. Good to be back. Just came back from holiday, wonderful holiday with my family, and also another journey with my wife and daughter. And when we were going back from the Belgian coast, we were driving on the motorway, and suddenly one of my tire just exploded in the middle of the road, and my daughter was sleeping in the back with my wife, and I was just worried because we were in the middle of nowhere, what to do. So I'm just thankful to God that although we had to wait 2 hours to be helped, and I was really frustrated, and the only place we could go was to Yumbo. There was a Yumbo there. I'm grateful that my wife could spend great time with my daughter at Yumbo while we were waiting for someone to come and help us. And during that 2 hours of waiting, and the only thing God was telling me was just be thankful. So it's amazing that this morning when we came late, but we just arrived at the moment. The slide was thankfulness. So it's just amazing to see how God is speaking to us, and I'm so thankful to come back, see my church, my family, and to hear all the testimonies that God is doing in your life. So that is good.
Thank you. Thank you.
something, that's bad for you. As you go surrounded by the presence of God. May the grace of the Lord Jesus, the love of that new Father, and the friendship of the Holy Spirit go with you. And may you go enjoying the goodness that He gives, interacting with God in that goodness, and recognizing that He deserves all the thanks for it, because He's the one who is good. May you have a blessed Sunday.